praise God.
Praise Him.
As you join me in word of prayer, please. Matches God, we come humbly. We come to God, appreciate you.
Oh God.
We come with God, acknowledging that you are God.
Yes, yes.
Dear God, we celebrate you and all that you have done.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, dear Lord, for allowing us to know you, to love you, to surrender to you. Thank you that you came as Savior and not as Judge. Thank you, dear God, for your redemption. Yes.
Thank you.
For the opportunity, oh God, that you have given us that we might be reconciled to you. What an awesome
hallelujah
opportunity. What a gift.
Yes.
That you didn't throw us away, but you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
You loved us and claimed us even when we were yet messed up.
Yes.
So we thank you, God.
Thank you.
Master, we pray that you would now speak to our hearts.
Please, Lord.
Our minds, dear God. Encourage us to love you more.
Yes, God.
God, give us the ability to see you clearly.
Yes, God.
And to be determined not to turn back.
Hallelujah.
We give you name praise. We give you honor. We give you glory.
Yes, Lord.
It's in the matchless and eternal name of Him who is Yahweh.
Yes.
Jesus, who is the Christ. We give pray.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Give an honor to Almighty God, who is the God Almighty. For everlasting, everlasting, He is God. We stand giving Him honor in this place tonight, the night that we celebrate His birth, His arrival, the Emmanuel coming to be with us, and we thank God. And we give Him honor. Give honor to Reverend Vivian Elright, my angel on loan. Thank God for her. And for Evangelist Smith, who has yeoman's share today.
Amen.
We thank God for her.
Amen.
And for each and every one of you coming out here tonight, and so that we can worship and celebrate our God together.
Amen.
You know, the stores have shiny lights, but we have the light.
Amen.
And we thank God for the privilege
of
coming to this place that we can celebrate who He is. Yes. But I'm going to invite you to come on and see Jesus with me, and I promised to get you out of here before Christmas. So if you will come on and see Jesus with me. The scripture that was read, we're going back to Luke chapter 2. That's the Christmas text, right?
Amen.
Luke chapter 2. And we're going to look at verses 10 and 11. Luke chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, to read. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be to all the people."
Mm-hmm.
They came. That's wrong. I'm sorry, y'all. This version messed up. It went from 10 to, it went from 210 to 216. That's not right. Okay, let's do it again. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, that's the other version. It got rid of some text. Well, all right. Praise God. That's it.
Amen.
That's the one. Oh, just for a little while, I want us, if you will, to consider with me. Let's consider together the Christmas miracle.
Amen.
The Christmas miracle. Now, we sometimes get confused with this thing called miracle. The enemy sometimes make us chase miracles rather than the miracle worker.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we We look so hard for the miraculous that we miss that God has already used what we would call natural to do or accomplish what we think we need a miracle to get done.
Well,
God has done some things in our lives and through our lives because we miss miracle. We think that a miracle is something beyond understanding. No, you can understand a miracle. See, all a miracle really is the revelation or the God interacting or becoming active in the predicament of humanity at a time and in a situation whereby man could not accomplish any other way what they need. So God shows up and gets done at that moment, time and space, mm-hmm. what you need to get done that couldn't happen any other way other than God show up.
Yes.
So you may be able to explain it. The timing just wouldn't have been right.
Uh-huh.
You may not understand the elements and the parts of it. You can say, well, I know how that happened. Somebody brought me some money. Yeah, but the only way you got your bill paid is God changed the heart of your enemy to come over and bless you. They don't even really know why. You understand the mechanism. You just don't understand the method. You don't understand what how God really made that thing work. But he made it work. And sometimes we miss the blessing because we're looking for a miracle. You see, the truth is that most of us say, give us a miracle. It's not really the miracle that you want. You don't really just want to be healed when you're sick. You want your life back. You want to be able to live. You want to be able to live without the pain of being sick or being disabled. You just don't want money when you're broke. You want the ability to pay your bills or to have some security. You see, there's a purpose that miracles are meant to serve. Miracles only come or only desirable because there's a greater purpose that we think we need a miracle in order to accomplish that purpose. So we're asking God, give me a miracle because I got a greater purpose. It's like this. When the children of Israel was leaving Egypt, God had to part the Red Sea. We say that the part of the Red Sea was a miracle, and it was. But they did not just stand there and watch the water roll up on both sides. What happened was when the waters opened up, they went across because the greater purpose was to escape the Egyptians who was coming to kill them. So the miracle would happen then. Now understand, we understand exactly how the Red Sea opened up. The Bible says that God sent an east wind that blew, and it blew it until a land bridge was made available for them to go across.
Yes.
So we understand how it happened, but the timing's the thing. The children, the Egyptians were behind them, and there was no way that they could get across the Red Sea fast enough to escape the Egyptians if God didn't show up.
All right.
So just because we can explain how it happened, and we know what made it happen, that doesn't necessarily determine what a miracle is. And the miracle itself is not the end game. The end game was to get out of the way of the Egyptians.
Yeah.
So there's this Christmas miracle. We talk about some of the miracles, but we might miss the end game. See, the end game is not just the miraculous.
Yeah.
It's not just the unexplainable. It's not just that all the things that we say, God showed up and worked a miracle in my life. Why do you need a miracle?
When
you ask yourself, why do I need a miracle? It brings you to the place where now you can see God give you the benefit of a miracle without doing something miraculous.
Okay.
In other words, God can give you peace without creating peaceful circumstances. God can give you victory over your enemy without killing it. God can do some things that will give you the benefit of why you need a miracle without doing what you think is a miracle. And I suspect that sometimes God slipped miraculous under us and we mislabel it as normal. The little part that we read here, the first thing that I saw that I thought was a little miraculous was this, and that is that angels was talking. You see, what all that says is that heaven knows where you are and willing to talk to you. You see, the angels. shepherds weren't in you.
Okay.
They didn't show up in North Africa because the shepherds were not in North Africa.
Where?
The angels had to go where the shepherds were because the shepherds needed to get the message of the good news. Mm-hmm. God knows where you are. God knows what you're going through. God knows what we're up against. God knows what's happening in our lives. We just got to be in place so when God starts speaking to us, we don't think something is strange. You see, it was that heaven was speaking to them where they were in the midst of their situation. And in the center of their circumstance, and in the heat of the battle, in the struggle of their lives, heaven started talking.
All right.
And I suggest to you, if you're willing to listen at the heat of your battle, in the midst of your mess, while you're still in your struggle, heaven will speak to you.
Yeah.
God will send a word to you that will speak to your situation.
Yes.
Now understand. The word didn't deliver them from being shepherds. The word just called them to something else.
Yeah.
And if you look at the text, God, the miracle that I see in this thing is that the good news gave peace.
Okay.
See, the only reason that the angel gave them not to be afraid was that something was telling, some good news was being told to them.
Okay.
In other words, the word of God was enough to chase their fear.
Okay.
When they got the word, there was no longer need of fear.
All right.
Sometimes we're just scared because we ain't got enough word. We're lost because we ain't got enough word. We want to give up because we don't have enough word. There's not enough word in our lives to give us the strength to stand against the storm. We think the storm is too great because we haven't heard that God is greater. We think that we need money for joy, and we haven't heard that God gives joy. We think that midnight's going to last all time, but we forgot that joy coming in the morning. There's this situation.
Yes.
This miracle. It's miraculous, y'all.
Yes.
It shows up here that the good news changed fear. The good news got rid of their fear.
Yeah.
The gospel overcame their fear.
Yeah.
Why am I afraid if I got the gospel?
Okay.
Because I miss the end game.
Okay.
You see, the end game wasn't just to chase the fear.
Yeah.
See, we call that the miracle. Sometimes we get done with that, but that's not the end game.
All right.
You see, the end game of chasing the fear away was to replace it with faith.
All right.
You see, as long as the fear was there, faith had no room to occupy.
Right.
But when the good news came, when the gospel came, when the word showed up, it pushed fear out the way and it gave room for faith. Why? Because faith was necessary for the next step. The principle, the end game of the gospel was to pull them closer to God. And it had to get rid of the fear in order to do that. So what we sometimes see,
Jesus.
And we're looking for miracles, and we're looking for something we miss. That we have to take step one before we can get to step two.
Okay.
Yes.
We have to do first things first.
Okay.
And the first thing is that we got to trust God's word enough to overcome whatever it is that's hindering us from wanting to see God.
Okay.
Whatever it is that gets between us and God, we got to trust God's word enough to get over it. If we think we're too young, God says you may not get old enough. If we think we're too old, God says we remember the days of youth, but trust me now. We got to trust God where we are right now in his word, because if we don't accept his word, the gospel won't chase fear.
All right.
And if fear is not chased out, then there is no room for faith. And the Bible says it is impossible to please God without faith. So we got to trust God enough to overcome the fear so that we can stand on the faith that God has called us. And that, my brother, my sister, is what pulls us closer to God. Because there's a faith that he allows us to go forward. So the miracle is that the angel was talking and gospel pushed fear. Faith was able to stand. That's the miracle. But the end game is God is saying, come on, now you got the faith, come closer.
Okay.
The end game is God gives us enough faith to trust him a little bit more.
Yeah.
God gives us enough faith to say, I'll trust you one more again, God.
Yeah.
He gives us enough faith to say, I'll try it again, God.
Yeah.
He gives us enough faith to said, I ain't going to give up on you now, God.
Yes.
And give him the faith to say no to things we didn't say no to. And yes to things that we didn't say yes to.
Yes.
And give us the faith to stand and trust God even when the way is dark, even when the load is heavy, even when folks seem like they're against us, when we seem like we're all alone. He gives us enough faith to say, I'll trust you anyhow. But in times when we get his word, that's why we need his word. Just in a little text, I see one more miracle.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to share it with you.
That's the Lord.
I think it's the greatest miracle of all. And that miracle is, the angel said, don't fear. Mm-hmm. Because born, now that's the first two miracles.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Don't fear, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. The gospel's getting, and the second miracle is, he's born.
Mm-hmm.
The third miracle is that unto you.
Okay.
Bless the Lord.
Okay.
Hallelujah.
See, that's a miracle.
Mm-hmm.
That God can know messed up me, nasty me, confused me, sinful me,
right.
Mistreated me, and how wasteful I am of the life he's given me, and still love me enough to come like me in order to redeem me. That is a miracle that the Savior was given unto me. God, I mess up every day in my life. I trash every day in my life. To go good news, but it's not just for you. But I'm giving it to you. But it's for everybody.
Yes.
Now that's one observation. I leave that question with you. How do you want to handle it? You might feel just I'm just privileged, or you might feel that the weight of responsibility, or you may cast them both off. I don't know. But it's in the text, and we have to confront what's in the Bible. And the Bible says it's a few shepherds got it. But it's for all people. Mm-hmm. What you gonna do, shepherd? How you gonna handle the responsibility, the privilege, the receiving of the message?
Glory. Mm-hmm.
That the Savior is born unto you.
Glory.
Bless your holy name, Jesus.
What you gonna do with that?
Thank you, Father.
Well, observation two may help. The second observation was this, that after they got the message, the angel said to them, I don't want you to go around unable to give an account of the hope that is in you.
Okay, now.
I don't want you to be one who have no answer for those who ask you why you have such great joy. I don't want you to fall victim to the academy who says you're operating on faith and not reason. That is, you're going with myth and not science. I don't want you to fall victim to them. So look, here is your evidence.
Yes.
You're going to see a baby. Mm-hmm. See, when God blesses you and miracle happens, there is evidence that happens. Now understand, most times we look for evidence of the miracle. If we say somebody got healed, we want to send to the doctor for another x-ray. If we say that somehow God has taken care of me and paid all my bills, we want to look at a bank account or cancel a due date.
Right.
We want to see evidence of the miracle.
Right.
But see, understand, they didn't see the evidence of a virgin birth. They saw a baby in the manger. Okay. That doesn't mean that the baby was born as a virgin. They didn't see evidence that the whole world was going to be happy. They just saw a baby in the manger. Why? Okay. Because God showed them the end game. God says, here is your evidence. Your evidence is what I tell you today is true tomorrow. What I tell you yesterday is true today.
Yes, my Lord.
Heaven.
Yes.
The evidence of heaven is the truth of God.
Hallelujah.
The evidence that God can do what God says is the fact that God cannot lie. The evidence that God is an overcomer is look in your own life. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. What do you mean, Pastor? If you look at your life, when you was all jacked up, a full grown, not nice person.
God
made you a babe.
Yes.
And gave you a chance to start over again.
King size bed just for you.
Stop looking at what God has given you. Stop looking at his for this miracles and observation. Because when you do that, shepherd, you can do like these shepherds. The Bible tells us that they went back celebrating, shouting, and praising God.
Yes, that's right.
Because they saw that everything God had told them was true.
Glory. Yes.
You will never know, excuse me, you will never be able to verify the truth of God if you don't trust Him enough to leave your comfort zone.
Come on, come on.
If you don't trust God enough to leave from where you are, you will never get to the place where you get to verify that what He told you was true.
Come on, Pastor. Come on.
So you will only stay in the midst of your pain and say, I don't think it's real.
Come on.
You've got to be willing to leave where you are and trust God so that He can show you that what He told you is true. He is a way maker. He is a provider. He will heal your heart. He will fight your battle. He will provide for you. He will pick you up. He will be a bridge. He will be a defender. But you got to leave where you are. You got to leave your comfort zone. You got to leave your self-constructed shelter.
Yeah.
The thing got holes in it anyway.
Yeah. Glory.
You got to leave.
Yeah.
And go on. I'm done, but I want to tell you this, why you shouldn't build your own shelter. Mm. Even though sometimes they work. You may know that this past summer, I built a woodshop, and I was working on a budget, a relatively small budget. But so I was looking for corners to cut.
Well,
and I knew better. Mm-hmm. I know the appropriate, the proper way to lay a foundation. I knew what I should have done. Mm. But I said to myself, if I do that, it's going to cost too much.
Come on, Pastor. Mm.
So what I ought to do is figure out a way to get close to what I'm supposed to do, but protect my budget.
Come on.
Well.
So I did my best work.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I put down the foundation, and I started building. Mm-hmm. The structure is great,
mm-hmm. Well,
but when I walk across the floor, I bounce.
Mm-hmm. Well,
if you look at it, people say, oh, great job. Mm-hmm. But every time I go in there, I remember I didn't do it right.
Come on. Mm-hmm. All right.
Every time I go in there, I remember.
Yes.
I knew what to do and I didn't do it.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Now the only way to really fix it
come on.
Is either lift the whole thing or tear it down and start over.
Oh my God. Mm. Come on.
So I made the decision that I'm going to use it like it is because I'm stuck with it.
Okay.
That's how sometimes we approach God.
Well,
we know He's the only sure foundation.
Okay.
Wow.
We know He's the only one who can stabilize our lives and keep us whole. But we say following Him costs too much. Following Him is going to embarrass me. Following Him is going to use too much of my life. Following Him is going to demand too much of my time. They're going to make fun of me. Following Him is going to embarrass me. I'll get close. Tell folk I'm a Christian. I go to church every now and then. I'll learn some of the language.
Jesus. Mm.
Ouch.
Oh God. Oh Lord.
And so we lay that foundation.
Yeah.
And everybody around us tell us how good we are. Mm. How good we look.
Yeah.
How well we speak.
Well,
how nice we are.
Glory.
We don't cuss, we don't act up, we're very polite.
Well,
chivalry is not dead, it lives in me. And everybody tells us how great we look.
Come on.
Well, every time you and I get into our own lives by ourselves, we feel all the doubts. We feel all the weak places. All the places that remind us that we're not really built on Jesus. All the places that remind us that we're really doing this on our own, that we're really not doing what God wants us to do. We look good on the outside, but on the inside, we see that it's bouncy in here, that the foundation ain't quite right. But the only way to fix it
is to lift.
The only way to fix it is lift it up or tear it down.
Come on, sir.
And we say, I spent too much time becoming me. I'm afraid to do that. And no. My life is built on this. No, he really do love me. No, she really. Well, no. I can't. No. I know it's wrong, but I know I'm going to keep on. Well, it costs too much. I'm going to do it this way.
Glory.
It's too painful. It's too much work to tear it down and start over. I don't have that much time left to tear it down and start over. I'm already doing good work. It's already served its function.
Yeah.
Wow. I'm not going to tear me down and start me over.
Come on, doctor.
I'm not going to give up on me and give me back. No.
Yes.
So we suffer.
Yes.
With the bouncy life.
Glory.
Jesus.
With the ups and downs. We suffer not knowing if what is going to happen. Is it going to stand or is it going to fall? Or will the rain wash it away? Will the next storm be the one that causes it to collapse? Will the next snow be too heavy for it to hold up?
Yes.
What's going to happen? When the, if a groundhog gets under it, what's going to happen? What's going to happen the next door? What's going to happen if my child moves away? What's going to happen if I get sick again? What happens if he really leaves my life? What happens? Can I stand? And that's what we do. But we don't have to.
That's right.
See, because the miracle is he's already built a new house.
Glory!
The miracle is he's already made you a new creation.
Hallelujah! Yes.
The miracle is he's already providing for you a foundation that is sure. You got to just trust him enough to move from one house to another. You just got to trust him enough to say, God, I will leave this place. I no more bouncy floors. No more afraid of what's going to come. But God, I trust you enough. See, the miracle of Christmas is he already done it for you. The miracle of Christmas, he showed up to be like you, to save you from you. The miracle of Christmas.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Do you know that no devil can send anybody to hell?
Okay.
No. Jesus came to save us from us because only us separating us from God.
Come on, Pastor.
Right.
So when he made a way for us to get back to God, he saved us from us. So we got to keep me from getting to where God wants me, because Jesus already prepared the way. Do you see the picture? God is sitting over there saying, come on. Jesus has built the bridge and come on the way. You all you gotta do is cross. And the Spirit of God is saying, come on, you can do it. Go, come on. Did you see that everybody, the Spirit of God, Jesus the Christ, and the Father all are trying to get you to reconcile unto God, and the way has already been made, and we got our heels dug in, come on. Can't pay the toll. It's a free road. There's no toll to be paid.
Hallelujah.
Come on. Let's do this thing, God's way. Let's do it.
That's good.
Let's do it God's way.
Yes. Amen.
The miracle of Christmas.
Yes. Thank you, Father.
Is that he came like you. So that he can rescue us.
Hallelujah.
And he's given us the ability to get rid of our fear so that we can handle him correctly.
Yes.
That we can say yes to a God who is able.
Bless your name, Jesus.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
Is it Christmas yet? All right, I got another sermon. All right, say that. Praise God. If you will, let's come to the altar. Let's have a quick prayer. Well, not about 8.